So last week, we started the book of John chapter 5. And if you remember, this is where John heals the paralytic man. And he does it on a Saturday of all days. And we closed last week's sermon with the idea, or the verse, verse 18, it says, "Therefore the Jews sought all the more to kill him, because not only did he break the Sabbath, but he also said that God was his Father, making himself equal with God." Making himself equal with God. This is where we're going to pick up with this theme of the equality of Jesus, the Son, with the Father. And, you know, it's interesting because as we go through the text this morning, we're going to see that not only does he declare himself equal with the Father, and this is Jesus speaking, but we're going to read about the equality with God in his power and the equality with God the Father in his authority. And so... really, it all stems from a doctrine that is very tough for people to comprehend. It's the doctrine of the Trinity, the Godhead, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And I believe in 1 John 5:7, and we'll look at it here shortly, it says, "And these three are one." And so what I want to do this morning is I want us to read through the text first. We're going to read from verses 18 all the way through 30. And then I want us to go back and kind of break it down and look at it. And then I want to look at some Old Testament passages and some New Testament passages to really kind of highlight this doctrine of the Trinity, the Godhead. Okay? Because there are some people out there that want to say that these are different beings, different gods, plural. And yet the scriptures teach very plainly that God is one. And we'll see that as we read through the different texts this morning. Well, not only that, but we have people that believe that you know, like Mormons, that will argue that we too will become gods. And what they do in their Bible is they change the verbiage, if you will. And so when you read a passage like John 1:1, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God," they insert the word "a," which changes the meaning entirely to fit their narrative. They try to say that the Word was a God. And this is not what the scriptures teach. When you start adding to the scriptures, adding to the word, or start taking away from the word, you're taking things out of context. And anything taken out of context is simply a con. It's a lie perpetrated by the devil and his demons. I was talking with some friends of mine yesterday at our men's breakfast. And we were talking about signs, miracles, and wonders, and how there are people that will try and fraudulently portray miracles and signs and wonders, and they take the attention all for themselves. And I think what it does is it causes people to doubt the Word of God. That's a ploy, a tactic of the devil. They want to confuse the truth of Scripture. They want to confuse the Word of God to cause doubt in people's minds. The reality when it comes to signs, miracles, and wonders, which have nothing to do with our sermon today, but just to kind of sidebar conversation, is the reality is the Scriptures teach boldly that in the last days that our children will do greater things than these. In reference to the signs, miracles, and wonders performed by Jesus and his disciples. And so if the Bible tells us that in the last days, and I believe we're in the last days, that they will do greater than things than they did in the days of Jesus, the days of the disciples, then I believe it. We should expect it. But because of all these charlatans out there that are perpetrating, that are fronting, making them out better than what they are, they cause doubts in the minds of young believers. And so is the same when it comes to the doctrine of the Trinity. The devil would like to confuse us in this doctrine. The devil does not want you and I to know God intimately. And so the scriptures, although the scriptures are designed to help us to know who God is and who his character is and what his attributes are, Satan would love nothing more to confuse us in this area, to doubt who God is. So let's read through the text. We'll go back. We'll take a look at it. Again, we're looking at Jesus' words here in chapter 5. There are people out there that says, well, nowhere in Scripture does it say that Jesus is God. Well, they have obviously hadn't read chapter 5, right, Jack? Amen? So let's pick up in verse 18. Again, I'm reading from the New King James Version of the Bible. It says, therefore, the Jews sought all the more to kill him, Jesus, because he not only broke the Sabbath, but also said that God was his Father, making himself equal with God. Then Jesus answered and said to them, most assuredly, I say to you, the Son can do nothing of himself, but what he sees the Father do. For whatever he does, the Son also does in like manner. For the Father loves the Son and shows him all things that he himself does, and he will show him greater works than these, that you may marvel. For as the Father raises the dead, he gives life to them. Even so, the Son gives life to whom he wills. Talking about the resurrection. Again, very important doctrine. A doctrine that separates Christianity from all other religions. He's giving the Son power to raise people from the dead and to give them life, life eternal. Then we read on in chapter or verse 22. For the Father judges no one, but commits all judgment to the Son, that all should honor the Son just as they honor the Father. He who does not honor the Son does not honor the Father who sent him. Again, he says, most assuredly, as if to say, I'm not lying here, I'm telling you the truth. Most assuredly, I say to you, he who hears my word and believes in him who sent me has everlasting life. Kind of echoing the passage out of John 14, verse 6, where Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man gets to the Father except through me, through Jesus, right? But he goes on to say, that who hears my word and believes in him who sent me has everlasting life and shall not come into judgment, but has passed from death into life. Again, most assuredly, I say to you, the hour is coming, and now is when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. For as the Father has life in himself, so he has granted the Son to have life in himself and has given him authority to execute judgment. Also, because he is the Son of Man, do not marvel at this, for the hour is coming in which all who are in the graves will hear his voice and come forth. those who have done good to the resurrection of life, and to those who have done evil to the resurrection of condemnation. I can of myself do nothing. As I hear, I judge, and my judgment is righteous, because I do not seek my own will, but the will of the Father who sent me. A lot going on here. But listen, there's a couple things that I want us to discuss and kind of unravel here, unwrap, if you will, to dig deep into. The idea of the doctrine of the Trinity, but I also want to talk about the roles and positions of the Godhead, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. And I want us to really kind of grasp a particular concept, the idea that these three are one. We know they're one. We see in Genesis chapter 1. And I will try, and as we turn to these passages, give you time to turn to them as well in your Bible, because it's important that you see this stuff for yourself. It's the idea that we trust but verify. In Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, it says, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was on the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters." So in this passage, we have both the Father and the Spirit, both present at the beginning of creation. John 1:1, I've already quoted to you, but I will look at it again. It says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God." And so when we look at Genesis 1:1 and John 1:1, we see that in the beginning, we have the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So wait a minute, Tom, you just said it was the Word. Well, we know from John 1, verse 26, John 1:26, it says, "And the Word became flesh," right? It says, let's see where we at. John. Where is it? "And the Word became flesh." I think it was 1:14. I'm sorry. "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth." 1:14. And so we see the Word is actually the Son, Jesus Christ, right? Because he's the begotten of the Father. We see them in the beginning, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Well, we also see in Genesis 1:26, it says, "Then God said, let us," plural, "make man in our," again, plural, "image, according to our likeness." So in the beginning, the Father is having a conversation. And we know he's having a conversation with the Son and the Spirit, because we see that in the beginning, it was the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit was there at the beginning. And he says in Genesis 1:26, "Let us make man in our image." He also says that in Genesis 11. You remember Genesis 11 was the account of the Tower of Babel, where people spoke all the same language. And they decided that they wanted to build a city and to build a tower that reached above the heavens. They wanted to usurp God's authority. And in Genesis 11, picking up in verse 5, but the Lord came down to see what the city and the tower which the sons of men had built. And the Lord said, "Indeed, the people are one, and they have one language, and this is what they begin to do. Now, nothing that they purpose to do will be withheld from them." So he says in verse 7, come, use the same phrase again, "Let us go down and confuse their language, that they may not understand one another's speech." When you when you seek to usurp God's authority, God's going to intervene. Satan and his demons tried to usurp God's authority and they were cast out of heaven. But the point being is that we see the plurality of God, but yet God is one. Notice what it says in Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy chapter 6. Beginning in verse 4, he says, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one." The Lord is one. And he goes on to talk about, "And these words which I command you today shall be in your heart, and you shall teach them to diligently to your children." All right? Notice what it says. Let's go over to the New Testament. Notice what it says in 1 John, towards the back of the Bible, chapter 5, verse 7. "For there are three that bear witness in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit. And these three are one." These three are one. When you take the scriptures out of context, there's some people that want to argue this passage here and says, well, they're just like-minded. They're in agreement. No, they're one. The only way that Jesus could have the same power, the same authority as the Father, is if he in fact was God. And this is where people struggle. They struggle with the idea of the Trinity. It's hard to understand. Every explanation of the Trinity that we give, all the different analogies or the examples, they all seem to fall short in one way or the other. The closest one I can think of myself that, you know, I didn't create myself. I didn't come up with this thought. It's not an original thought. Nothing new under the sun, right? But I've heard it from other people. It makes sense to me. Is looking at H2O. H2O in a solid state is ice. In a vapor state, steam. In a liquid state, water. But it's all H2O. God is God, period. You've got them in different forms. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. But much like H2O, where you have vapor or steam, you have liquid, solid. In each of those different forms, H2O serves a different purpose, a different function. God, singular, in their different forms, serves a different purpose, a different function. But it's still God. One God. Now, the reality is, I've made a statement, again, I've heard it from other people, and it made sense to me, and so I've regurgitated it. I've talked about it. I've made comments in the past about, you know, God the Father's job is to judge. The Spirit's job is to convict, guide, teach, correct, convict, right? And the Son's job is to love. And I tell people, Ephesians 5:1, we're to be imitators of God and of Jesus, right? And we're to love people. And then somebody in here brought this chapter to me, this verse to me, where God is imparting, delegating, if you will, judgment to the Son. And the reality is, when you look at creation, when you look at judgment, when you look at the different functions of the Godhead, it's still one God. Jesus makes clear in this passage here that he can do nothing outside of the will of the Father. And what his Father does is what he does. Notice what it says. Right here I got to get back to chapter 5. The Father, verse 22, the Father judges no one, but has committed all judgment to the Son, that all should honor the Son as they honor the Father. He who does not honor the Father, wait, let me go back a little bit. Where are we at? Yeah, we can just keep on reading. He who father honors the Father honors who honors the Son does not honor who. Blah. I apologize. He who does not honor the Son does not honor the Father who sent him. And he says, "I say to you, he who hears my word and believes in him who sent me has everlasting life. He shall not come into judgment, but has passed from death to life. I tell you that the hour is coming." Let's see, where's the point I'm making here? I went too far. Okay, so we need to back up. Back up. It says, "Most certainly I say to you, the Son can do nothing of himself. The Son can do nothing of himself, but what he sees the Father do." This is verse 19. "For whatever he does, the Son also does in like manner." This is the point I'm making. Jesus can only do what the Father does. The Spirit can only do what the Father does. None of them can do anything on their own accord. It's like saying that, you know, playing sports or something like that. It's like me saying, okay, I'm going to play basketball as a student, but as a father, I can't do that. Well, that's ridiculous. I can do that, even as a father. Maybe not with my knees. My knees are getting worse. But I could still do those things, right? The Father can create. He can judge. He can love. He can do all these things, right? Well, so can the Son. So can the Spirit. Because it's the same God. God breaks it down for us, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, so we can grasp his character a little better, but it's still God, one God. And this is where people struggle. Right here in chapter 5, Jesus is saying that the Father has delegated judgment to himself. But notice what it says in 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2. "My little children, these things I write to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father." So in this verse, who's the judge? Who's the judge in this verse? I'll read it again. "My little children," John's writing, "my little children," writing to believers, "these things I write to you so that you may not sin. And if anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And he himself is the propitiation for our sins. And not for ours only, but also for the whole world." So in this passage, who's the judge? Who's the advocate? Jesus, right? Jesus is advocating on our behalf, like much like a defense attorney. But if Jesus is the advocate, who's he advocating to? The judge, right? In this case, the Father. And so the reason I bring this verse up is not that the scriptures contradict themselves, but they're in harmony with one another. It's the idea that when you think about judgment or you think about love or forgiveness, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, their roles are interchangeable. They all have the same power and authority. And this is what Jesus is saying of himself in John chapter 5, is I have the same power and authority of the Father. Why? Because we are God, singular. We're one. Not like-minded, but we're one. And this is what he's saying. Why is it important to understand this concept? What's the significance of it all? What do you think? Why is it important that Jesus is in fact God? What bearing does that have on our lives? What do you think? Not rhetorical. I'm just curious, what do you think? Why is it important?
Whatever he says, God is speaking.
Whatever he says, it's God speaking. All right? Absolutely right. Why else? Think about it from a personal applicational standpoint. God loves us so much that he died for us. He died for us. He went to this cross that you and I belong on because of our own sinfulness. Think about the Romans road. Romans 3:23, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, right? We've all sinned, right? You continue down the Romans road and it says, punishment of our sin is what? Death. We deserved to die for our sins that we've committed. But yet, despite our sinfulness, God says, you know what? I love you too much. I will take your place on the cross. I will take your place. God is saying, I will bear the sins of the world on this cross so that those who believe in me, those who desire a right relationship with God, can be clothed in his righteousness. Amen? What an honor. What a privilege to be clothed in God's righteousness. Remember, the scriptures teach us that light and darkness can't fellowship. And so unless we're made clean, we have no fellowship with God. It was through God's blood shed on the cross that washed us clean from all of our sinfulness, from all of our wretchedness, so that we can have a right relationship with him, an intimate relationship with him. This is why God says, look, call me Abba, right? Call me Daddy. I want to have that kind of relationship with you. I want you to come to me. Listen, I have 3 grown kids. I told you I have 5 grandsons. And there's no greater joy when my kids or when my grandkids, they look at me with their eyes and they're, Papa. It just melts my heart. This is what God wants. He wants us to look at him and say, Papa, I love you. This is what he desires. This is why he went to the cross. It's important to understand the Godhead, the Trinity. Because, yes, Jesus was the one that was hanging on this cross. He was the one that was being crucified, but in reality, it was God. Singular. And it becomes difficult because we see scriptures, we see passages where Jesus is crying out to the Father, why have thou forsaken me? And that's a struggle. It's a hard piece of doctrine for anybody, for sure. But if God can create the universe, everything that we know, see, touch, smell, breathe, if he can create all things, if he has that kind of power, if he has the kind of power that can raise the dead back to life, if he has the kind of power that we saw last week where he's healing the paralytic man that's been paralyzed for 38 years, simply by saying, hey, get up and walk. Grab your bedroll, walk. And he does. He just speaks it, right? He's got the power to turn water into wine. He's got the power to heal blind men. He's got the power to walk on water. He's got the power to take Philip, who's talking to an Ethiopian eunuch. He baptizes him, and then when the eunuch comes up out of the water, it says Philip was no more. He snatched him up, disappeared him, put him somewhere else. If he's got that kind of power, don't you think he's got the power to separate himself to a degree for a moment in time? See, the reality is, because of our own sinfulness, we deserve to die. The word death in the scriptures translates total separation from the Father. So in order for the Son to truly take our place on the cross, he had to be totally separated from the Father. If God has the power to do all these other things we just listed out, don't you think he has the power to do that? And he did it simply because he loves you and me. Amen? This is why it's important to understand the Godhead, the Trinity. Because everything we read about the Son is true about the Spirit, and it's true about the Father. One God. One God. Luke 19 tells us that the Son of Man came to seek and to save that which was lost. Namely, you and I. The Bible says it's God that draws us to the foot of the cross. It's God that softens our hearts and our minds to be in a position to receive truth, to receive love, to receive forgiveness. It's that same God through the Holy Spirit that empowers us to live holy and righteous lives, a life that's free from sin. Why else does he tell this paralytic man to go and sin no more? Why else does he tell the woman at the well to go and sin no more if it was not possible? But it is possible through Christ who strengthens us. Amen? When we study the scriptures about who the Father is, who the Son is, who the Holy Spirit is, and then we put it all together and understand it's the same God, one God. The more we study about the individual aspects of God, the more we understand God fully. And the closer and more intimate we can have the relationship grow in him, in Christ. Amen? This is why Jesus shares this with those who are trying to persecute him. The dispute here is that he is God, and they were enraged that he would say such a thing. They would say that Jesus is blaspheming. The reality is the Pharisees were the blasphemers, for they rejected God, right? This morning, as we begin to take communion, I want us to think about everything that we've studied here this morning. Understand that God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, they are one. And they, in the form of the Son, one God, hung on this cross for you and for me. We're going to have the bread and the communion is going to be, the cup is going to be passed. And I want us to, again, marinate on this idea. We tend to focus, when we take communion, we tend to focus on the Son. We tend to focus on the words of Jesus as he instituted communion, where he said this, when he took the bread and he says, "This is my body that's broken for you. And so we naturally we think about the Son. We think about the Son. When he takes the cup and he says, this is a symbol of the new covenant, right? The covenant of my blood that's going to be spilled for you, that's going to be shed for you. We think about the Son. But Father, Son, Holy Spirit, these three are one. And so as we take communion this morning, I want you to think about the fact that it wasn't just the Son that loved us, that gave his life, but it was God, singular, that loved us. Enough to hang on this cross. Loved us enough to be separated in himself. Bless you. Bless you again. You're looking for a double blessing. We've just got a few more people that need to receive the elements and we'll pray. But I want you to think about what it is that God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, what it is that God did for you so that you can have life everlasting. You know, one thing I didn't really talk about here, but while we're waiting for people to be served, I'll go ahead and highlight momentarily here, is the fact in this passage here, it talks about the resurrection of the dead, the resurrection, what the resurrection would look like for those who believe versus those who don't believe. Those who believe, we've been made alive in Christ as we're living here on this planet. But the resurrection that we have hope in is a resurrection unto life everlasting. And sadly, for those who don't believe, is a resurrection for the sole purpose of final judgment. This is why it's so important that we share the gospel with our friends and our family that we love. Help them to understand the importance of being all in for Christ, for God. Being all in, walking in the Spirit and not walking in the flesh. This bread is the body of our Lord being broken. He says, take this as often as you come together in the remembrance of me, in the remembrance of God. Likewise, he took the cup. And he says, as often as you take this cup, I want you to remember that the shedding of my blood is necessary so that you could be made clean. And so that night in the upper room when he took the cup, he held it up and he says, as often as you come together, I want you to take this in remembrance of me. Father God, we thank you so much. In fact, our thanks, our mere thanks is not even enough. It can't possibly be enough to show our appreciation for what you did for us on this cross. The idea that the triune God, even before the foundations of the earth, came up with a plan of salvation because he knew the disastrous work of the devil there in the garden. that separated mankind from his creator. That act in the garden ushered in a life of sin for everyone that is born, unless they repent and they trust in your forgiveness, in your grace, in your mercy. That plan of salvation that was laid out before the foundation of the earth was realized at the cross, was realized in the hearts of and mind of everybody that you draw unto yourself. For those of us that go to the foot of the cross and humbly repent and to turn from our sins, all that was possible because of what you, Lord, did for us. We thank you for that. We thank you, give us the word. So we can see and understand what you desire from us. Lord, I pray that we would live lives that would be worthy of your sacrifice. That if we find ourselves in a moment of lapse, in a moment of poor judgment where we end up falling into sin, that we would repent immediately. That we would be purposed to live a life that would honor you. And that we would remember always who we are in Christ, in God. And that we would walk according to the Spirit and not the flesh. We pray this in Jesus' name by the power of your Spirit, Lord. Thank you and amen. All right, okay, our last song. Our closing song this morning. Open the eyes of my heart.
As we sing, holy, holy. holy, holy, I want to seek you. Holy, 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 I want to see you. Worthy, 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 you are worthy.
Thank you all for coming to Calvary Chapel Aspen Trails. It's been a pleasure. It's been a blessing to be able to minister to you this morning. And I hope and pray that you join us for some fellowship in the next room, for some coffee or tea or whatever. I appreciate you guys. My prayers continue to be with you. Grace and peace to you all. God bless and have a wonderful, blessed day.